Hello, and welcome to Cross City Church. I'm Russell, and I'm so glad you're here with us today to celebrate the 120th anniversary of Cross City. Our celebration is about to start, so if you're still in the lobby, come on into the worship center. For those of you with us online, today is a significant day. We're celebrating 120 years of God's faithfulness. We'll enjoy a special day of worship and take a closer look at what God's done through the years. If you're joining us online, we hope that you feel right at home. This church has always been about connecting people with each other, and that's true regardless of where you are. If you're joining us from crosscity.church/live, you can chat, get notes, find links, and request prayer all from one place. So head that way and join the conversation to let us know you're here. Now, let's celebrate the goodness of God together. Let's pray and get started. Heavenly Father, we just come to you thanking you for this incredible day, a great day of celebration. Let's pray now that you be with our pastor as he brings the message. And we ask all of this in the name of
Jesus. Good morning and welcome to Cross City Church. Welcome to our 120th anniversary celebration service. Woo! That's right. My name is Brad Riley. I'm the worship pastor here at Cross City. And I wanted to start with the word. Is that all right with y'all? Cool. Psalm 89 says, I will sing of the loving kindness of the Lord forever. To all generations I will make known your faithfulness with my mouth. For I have said, loving kindness will be built up forever. In the heavens you will establish your faithfulness. Now I think about that first verse. I will sing of the loving kindness of the Lord forever. And in each of y'all's minds, I know that you can think of all kinds of different ways to sing of the loving kindness of the Lord, right? There's different songs that are popping into your heads, I hope, right now. And here at Cross City, across all venues and campuses, we typically sing between 3 and 5 worship songs each Sunday. But today, we have 24 songs in 25 minutes. All right? Well, we've worked hard on this. This group has worked incredibly hard, and I'm proud of them. We want to invite you to just remain seated for now, and I'll ask you to stand later on. But we're going to start with the foundations, the songs that have been sung before our time, the songs that are sung when I was a kid, during our time, and Lord willing, they will be sung long after our time. We'll start there, and then we'll go through the decades. Sound good? Y'all sing along with us. Y'all have a fun time. And if you hear something you know, shout out. Come on. Let's have a good time. Here we go.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he hath done. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory.
Come on now.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wondered how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen.
So I know how you feel. His death was so real. But please listen and hear what I say. I've just seen Jesus.
Just see Jesus.
cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength but His. There's no greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ.
Sing praise.
trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless I stand before the throne.
Church family, let's sing that again together.
When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless I stand before the throne.
Ephesians 2 says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace we have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. That is what we're here to celebrate, his grace and kindness towards us here at Cross City, his faithfulness, his goodness, his mercy towards us. This is what we sing to, this is what we worship for. So let's stand, let's sing his praises now. Let's sing Christ alone, cornerstone.
Christ alone, cornerstone. Weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
We worship you, Lord.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Come.
somos iglesia en mi vida.
En mi vida ha sido bueno. En mi vida ha sido tan, tan fiel. Con mi ser, con cada aliento, yo cantaré de la bondad de Dios.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so
sing that together. Glory to his name. Here we go.
Glory to his name.
Oh, to your name alone.
There to my heart was the blood applied.
Wow, what a morning. What an opportunity to praise the Lord today. And you know, in the middle of our services in this room every Sunday, we have a dedicated time of prayer. I'm going to invite you, if you want to come to the altar today, maybe it's coming to the altar is something you do every week. Maybe it's something that's been years since you've come. But this is an altar of prayer today, and I want to ask you to come and make your way down right now for a time of gratitude, a time of thankfulness. So I want you to come to the Lord today. And maybe you have a need in your life. You can tell him that, certainly. But also thank him. Thank him. The Bible says we're to be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, we're to make our request known to God. And then the promise is the God of peace and the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Maybe there's something you're particularly thankful for today, and I want you just to take a moment. And I want you to give thanks to God for that. Maybe there's something that you need for God to intervene into your life about, a family member or yourself or some other situation. Just ask him for it today with thanksgiving. God, I don't know how you're going to answer this, but I'm going to give thanks to you now for whatever you're going to do. And that's what I want us to do. I want you to lift your voice up, whether you're at the altar or wherever you are in the building. Lift up your voice over these next few moments to the Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, listen to your people pray. Hear us as we come in the name of Jesus boldly before the throne of grace, because you've invited us to, you've made it possible. So hear us as we pray today. Now lift your voice, church. Lift your voice to the Lord who hears you. Call out to him. Father, in Jesus' name, all over this room, people are calling out to you. And Lord, I know your promise is that you'll hear them when they come in the name of Jesus. And some of them are simply praying prayers of gratitude. Thank you, God, for your goodness and your mercy and your loving kindness and your forgiveness. Thank you for your presence. Some of them are asking, Lord, that you step into their lives, give them answers or provision or next steps, or healing, or help in some way. And Father, may your grace be multiplied to them right now. Lord, give us the wisdom that we have, that we need so desperately, but give it to us from above, your wisdom above all else. Lord, thank you so much for the fact that we can celebrate your goodness over these 120 years of how you've worked in the people of this church and the lives of those that have met you here and through their lives as they've shared with others. Thank you so much that we can come and celebrate your goodness today. You are good. And Father, I ask you today that you just be real to us in this experience today. Be very present. We're so grateful that you are. Lord, we ask all this together in Jesus' name. And all God's people in this building said, amen, amen. And when you make your way back to your seats, those of you at the front, please reach out to someone that you haven't said hello to. Welcome them, whether they're here for the first time or back after 10 years. Welcome them.
Good morning. What an incredible day we have as you make your way back to your seat. I know you've probably seen some family, some friends, some fellowship workers that you've been around, but I haven't seen in a while, and we want to give you that opportunity to meet and greet them and just say hello to them. But we want to continue in our worship at this moment, and we want to thank you so much for coming to Cross City Church for the 120th anniversary celebration. You think about that, yes. 120 years, what an incredible opportunity. And that's what we get to do today. Today we get to pause to think about God's faithfulness over the last 120 years. And hopefully when you came in this morning, you were able to receive a guide just like this. And in this, it kind of talks just a little bit about the last 120 years. But more importantly, it gives you a map of what is taking place in our commons. We have 5 displays out in the commons area, kind of walking you through the different artifacts that have been put out there to walk you through the last 120 years. If you have not gotten the opportunity when you came in to go through that, we want to encourage you to do that. But that disc didn't appear. There were many people that spent countless hours combing through the different artifacts, combing through the different things that had gone on over the last 120 years to go through there to set that up so that we could enjoy that. I know I got the opportunity. I saw a picture of my dad out there, saw some writings. It was really, really cool to see that. So we just want to pause just for a second for the people that have helped put that together over the last several months. Join me today as we give thanks to the ones that helped put that together. Their names will be appearing on the screens that you see up there. Incredible for all the times that they put in there. Continue. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for all the people, the hours, the countless hours that they put in so that we can enjoy to celebrate today. Also, we want to encourage you to be able to go through and see the Hall of History. If you did not get that opportunity earlier today, the Hall of History is right outside the Commons area, right by our Totscape. It's a hall, again, it takes you through the last 120 years. It's an incredible display as well. And then one last thing. If you're getting hungry, that's good because we have a food truck, we have a barbecue waiting for you. If you want to be able to stick around and have some lunch with us today, we'd love for you to do that to continue in this celebration. Now, guest, first-time guest, we are extremely excited that you chose to be with us this morning. You could have been anywhere this morning. You chose to be here, and we are so grateful that you are here this morning. We would love the opportunity just to be able to meet with you. There is a QR code in the seat in front of you. If you would not mind scanning that QR code, and then right after the service, we would love to meet you in our guest reception. It's right outside the center exit doors in our guest reception room. It'll take about 10 to 15 minutes to be able to meet you, to share you more about our church family and why we want to be able to connect with you to be a part of this church family. And then next week, we have our next step class. Our next step class of joining the church family starts at 9:30 on Sunday morning. Next week, you can find out more about our next step class at crosscity.church/next-step. Now, I want to think about this for a second. 120 years. 120 years of God's faithfulness, but 120 years of faithful giving by people just like you. We thank you for your continued giving and your faithfulness in giving so that we can get outside of the four walls, get into the community and be the hands and feet of Jesus to meet the needs of the people. So thank you for your continued generosity. If you have a gift today, you can text the word Cross City to 45888, or you can leave your gift with the ushers as you leave. Now let's continue in our worship and let's hear from our pastor, John Metter.
We are so very glad that you're here today, and I know that we have a number of people that are back from years ago and some from other states and other cities, and a lot of special people in the room, including you. And so we want to just say welcome to you today. And this is really a great opportunity for us to say something about the goodness of God. In fact, the whole focus of this morning is celebrating God's goodness. You know, a church never, ever should say, "Look, we did it," because that's not how things work in the church. Just like it doesn't work like that in a Christian's life, "I did it." It's always Christ in me, the hope of glory. It's always what he does in us and through us. But we can celebrate that, can't we? We can take time to say, God did some amazing things over the course of our 120-year history. Just take a moment and say thanks to God for what he's done in your life over the course of the history of this church life. Would you take a moment and do that? I'm so grateful. So I'll remind you of why we're here today, and I'll be sharing some things about the history of the church, but also I'm going to have some time where we get really personal with you about God's goodness in your own life. But let me just start with Psalm 77. Verse 11 and 12 of Psalm 77 remind us of what we ought to be doing on a regular basis. Here the psalmist says, "I shall remember the deeds of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on all your work and muse on all your deeds." The psalmist says it's really important for us to take a step back and say, "God did this," or "God did that," or "I saw him intervene in my life," or "in the life of someone else." It's important for us to pause to do that. That's tough to do today, to pause and to be quiet and to think a little bit about what God has done in the past. And also, everything that we do today is going to reflect on God's goodness Even though lives and churches have highs and lows, they have mountain peaks and valleys, when we look back, we always see the goodness of God at work. Can you see that in your life? Paul said it like this in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And I love how familiar he is with this verse and how familiar we should be with this verse. And we know, he says, and we know, help me finish this verse. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Do you know who the called are? Those of you that have found faith in Jesus Christ and are a part of the church, you are the called according to his purpose. And according to this verse, all things work together for good. Even when bad things happen, tough things happen, even when it's not mountain peak all the time and the valleys actually happen and dark moments happen in your life, you look back and you can see one thing, that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God, those called according to his purpose. So we're going to celebrate that today. We're going to talk about that, how that looks in a church context. Now, I need to recognize a few people today and just acknowledge some folks today that we are very grateful that are with us today. One of those individuals, a couple actually, is Jimmy and Carolyn Draper. They're in the room today, a former pastor here for many years. Carol, Ann, and Jimmy, would you wave right there? They're down here on the fourth row. And you'll see the era of his church leadership on the wall if you have an opportunity to go see that, or at the booth. It's great for you to sit there and look at what God has done through their leadership during that era. Bill Anderson would be with us today, but it's in the hospital. Keep him in mind in prayer if you would. And but those two guys have been big shoulders we stand on. In a few moments, you'll see a video of not only Jimmy Draper and Bill Anderson, but also Claude Thomas and myself, four pastors over 60 years, talking about the goodness of God as he's expressed it through this church. We also have former staff members and their families in the room today. I wouldn't be able to call your name out, but would you stand if you're a former staff member or a family member of a former staff member? Stand right now for just a moment, if you would. Wherever you are, let's acknowledge them. Man, we're glad. Thank you for being here with us. Now, there are other former members that are here to come back maybe from 10 years ago or 5 years ago, whatever it may be. We also have a group that fit in that category of the Broken Ground, Student Ministry Broken Ground. Would you stand up as well so we can see those of you that have come back to celebrate with us today? A number of them. That's great. Amen. We will invite Broken Ground to come up on the stage at the end and do their little dance. And then we have some VIPs that have joined us. Our mayor and city council members are here today. Mayor Linda Martin, right over here. Jeremy and Lori Tompkins. And also Eddie Price, our own Eddie Price here. Thank you so much for being in the room today. Joe Davis is here with the Southern Baptist of Texas Convention. Joe, we're thankful for your presence in the room today as well. Give him a hand if you do that. But the most important person in this room is you, each of you. As you think about the goodness of God, and you think about how he's worked in the life of this church, and in the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life. Some time ago, I preached a message about the importance of the church, and I came from this text I'm about to read to you. It's Ephesians 2, verse 19 through 22. As Paul describes the church, of course, Paul is absolutely in love with the church because he knows it's the bride of Christ. He knows it's the body of Christ. And as an apostle who was also a church planter, it's very near and dear to his heart. So he's describing, in a sense, theologically, what the church is all about. And in doing so, he tells us what makes this place so special and what makes any church where God works powerfully so special. And here's what I'm going to read for you. Paul says, "So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but are fellow citizens with the saints." You went from being a stranger and an alien without Christ in your life to being a fellow citizen with the saints. "And you are of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the cornerstone." We sang about that this morning. And then he goes on and says, "In whom the whole building fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, and whom you are also being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. Now, we know this about God. We know that God is ever-present. He's everywhere. He's omnipresent. But Paul knows that, and yet at the same time says, the church is the dwelling place of God in the Spirit. In other words, God will manifest himself as the church gathers. God will work and speak as the church gathers. God will use the members of the church to do his work of the kingdom in the communities in which they live by the power of his Holy Spirit. And that's why when we celebrate what God is doing in the church, we're celebrating what the Holy Spirit is doing in the individual lives and in our lives corporately. And we can say God most manifests himself here. God most reveals himself in a church who is hungry for God. Now, that's not just true of this church. That's true of any church who's hungry for God, who's hungry for his word, who's hungry to be the body of Christ. But we can look back on our 120 years and say, we've seen God's goodness as we've pursued him. I want you to listen to the perspective of the goodness of God from these four pastors I mentioned. Turn your attention to the screen. When I think about the church, I think about the goodness of God from era to era to era. Looking back over the 120-year history, I think about great leadership eras of men that we know a great deal about. People like Bill Anderson, Jimmy Draper, Claude Thomas. Those pastors who led, those people who were a part of that, they're the foundation that we stand on today.
I was only 29 when they called me to be their pastor, which means I had very little experience in the pastoral world, having been saved as a junior in high school. And so I had no tradition, no background. Nobody in my family tree ever, either in America or in Europe, had ever been a pastor. And I was the first, and so I barely knew how to spell the word. But the thing that I remember vividly about Eunice in particular is that they wanted somebody to be their leader. They had confidence before I got here in leadership. They had two men who preceded me, good men, who could not be full-time pastors. And their theory was, we need a full-time pastor. I was told that I was the first full-time pastor they ever heard.
Do you know they have had 30 pastors since 1904? There are a lot of us had the privilege of serving at Eunice, but the strength of the church is in the character of the people.
It's about the hundreds and even thousands of names of deacons, teachers, leaders, people working in our preschool, door greeters, ushers, people that were saying, what's my part of this vision?
That's how we got our crisis pregnancy center. I preached a sermon, and out of that sermon, we started our crisis pregnancy center. I didn't preach the sermon to start anything. It was the people who grabbed it and said, we need to do something about this. That's the church. It's a forgiving church, a church that loves people. They love to help people. Just remarkable in every way.
They gave themselves to reaching a younger generation. And it was such an encouraging thing to see that in the lives of the people, because they embraced that emphasis and that vision to reach that younger generation as well as nourish those who were there. You could see God move because we had students doing things at the church that were sort of out of the norm. Students leading people to Christ on the streets of Boston. I mean, you have to know that's the grace and the goodness of God.
One of the things we did right was put the Bible in proper focus. We took the Bible seriously. And as you know, today we're seen to be essentially in that same process.
We just feel like our job is to continually preach and teach that the Bible is God's word and it's sufficient for every need we have.
Strong biblical preaching. I'm not the guy that came and brought that. I'm the guy that came and said, can I carry that baton? Because that baton is a heavy one and an important one. And I think about my own personal gratitude for the way they led and so many victories that were taking place during those days.
I saw God change hearts. The outgrowth of that was the celebration and the life change and the growth of the church.
We had double-digit growth in finances and in new members every year for 15 years. That's phenomenal. That's who but God could do that.
It was an amazing time in the life of the church. And we got to the place where we reached so many people that the room was full. The vision was, and the idea of building a worship center, I didn't create that. That was already, it pre-existed my time. But when it came time to do it, that room and that building was dedicated to the worship of God and the celebration of Jesus.
When I think about some of the highlights of the goodness of God over the years, I think about beginning to watch people respond to the cross service, people standing up and our congregation responding with outright applause and even shouting for joy was overwhelming. I mean, that's a pretty powerful moment. The Not Ashamed services. Who can be down? Who can be depressed over people being baptized, responding to the gospel? It's just one of those things that just engenders joy into your life. Watching Six Stones get started as we endeavored to meet the needs of the community and knew we needed to have a broader representation of churches to do that. Those were exciting days. That we all stand on the shoulders of somebody that came before us, and we stand here with a great gratitude. We're very grateful for 120 years and the investments made and the sacrifices made to bring us to this point. And we stand here thinking about the fact that we're also laying a foundation for the next 10 and the next 20 years. So I could go on and on with all the great things that God has done to show us His goodness, the individual lives being changed, the individual families that have been healed, people called to ministry. And that's what life's all about. That's what the gospel life is all about. And through it all, we've maintained that we are real people with real hope and real life in Jesus Christ. And that's true. That's really what this world needs. And that's what I believe our church is. I'll bet we have 60 minutes of footage from each one of those pastors as we ask them to talk about the goodness of God. Can you imagine opening the mic up to a Jimmy or a Bill or Claude or any pastor who's seen God work in a powerful way and just recording their words and just listening to what they would say about how they saw God work and how lives were changed and what you caught just a glimpse of that. But we tried to tell the story in so many different ways. The displays outside in the commons, you'll see the wall if you haven't been by, the history wall. Please take time to do that later in the day as soon as the service is over. But I'm going to walk with you through some eras, the eras that you find on the back of your program guide. I'm just going to walk you through those in a very, very brief way. There's no way that we can be comprehensive. We can't give all the details. But what we can do is tell a few stories that remind us of the goodness of God through the years from 1904 and to present day. The very first era is what we call the laying the foundation era, and it's actually from 1904 to 1966. And that era was an era that took place not far from here, up near where the McDonald's is on Main Street and 183. And that's the building that you're looking at that really began this whole thing. On 3/26/1904, Charles Fitch, J.T. Bussey, along with the Jernigan family, opened the first meeting. And it's interesting that as they opened the first meeting and planned the first services of the church, that they didn't really realize that there are representatives from their families in the room still today, 120 years later. They're not here, but they've laid the foundation for their families also to be here. Isn't that cool? That those names still resonate inside of our walls. And like most Baptist churches or most churches that start, these were homes that they met in. Porches and living room, and then they were various structures that moved from very simple to a little bit more elaborate as time went on. And each pastor that was here in that first era was a part-time pastor in many degrees. They were sometimes bivocational and here for just a few short months or a year or two. I remember one story that I tell quite frequently is the decision to build a preschool room because they had children, and the children were kind of loud at that time during the services. They decided to, I'm not going to name any names, but they decided to build a preschool room. And in the business meeting where they voted to build the room, they also had a motion to amend the original motion. Instead of building a preschool room for one baby, they decided because of church growth reasons to build a preschool room for two babies. That really began their idea of a bigger vision to reach more and more people. Little stories like that we found as we researched our history and just absolutely loved hearing about it. Baptisms were a big part What a Baptist church would do. When people come to faith in Jesus, we're eager to baptize them because that's the command that Jesus gave us. But back in the day, they baptized in stock tanks. Now, we do that on Not Ashamed Day, where we have about four tanks on the stage, but they baptize them in stock tanks or in Callaway Lake. You might be interested to know. I've done some actual Google research, and I've learned that Callaway Lake, where we originally baptized people, is now Beridian Lake, and the beach of Beridian is where we originally began to baptize people as this church began. They buried a time capsule so well when they moved to this area of the city. They relocated. And I remember the story of these men signing co-signing the contract to pay for the land as they moved. And I remember talking to one that said, you know, I was afraid to put my name on that dotted line because it represented so much of most of my annual income. So I was hoping the church would stay solvent, but they bought the land together and that's where we are today. And it was a strategic move that we wouldn't understand how strategic it was until later on. The first building they built was Building A, and in our historical records, it shows that they put a time capsule in Building A. Recently, when we did our Generations project, we demolished Building A, and we looked everywhere for the time capsule, and they buried it so well, we could not find it, no matter how long we looked. So somewhere buried in our ground somewhere, or in the debris of our old buildings, is a time capsule that would say a lot of amazing things. They laid the foundation. Let me just tell you, the churches don't start with anything but hard work, sweat, and conviction that the gospel needs to get to every person. Someone said about these churches of that era is that as they began, there was nothing extra, there was nothing fancy about what they did, but it was all about reading the scriptures, finding salvation by faith in Jesus Christ, baptizing people, training them up, and making sure the next generation came to know Christ. At the essence, whatever the outside of a church looks like, whatever you see on the stage, that's still the essence of our mission, is to take the gospel to the next person. And they laid down the DNA for us, and they're laying the foundations. The building the family era came next. And in 1965 to 1975, Bill Anderson was the pastor of this church. And Bill Anderson is quite a guy. I was impressed with him from the time I met him 18 years ago. His focus was on relationships, and of course his family was a growing family during that time. He was just 29 when he came to pastor the church, and he stayed longer than any other previous pastor after that day. 10 years he stayed here as pastor of First Baptist Church in Euless. If you know Bill, you know he's tall, he's handsome, he's confident, and he's humble. I don't know how somebody has all those characteristics, but he's that football player from Baylor that has had the confidence of knowing that he was following the Lord. He's actually the first man, as he said, in his family to call to preach. And man, what a unique family atmosphere he built in the church. During this era, Euless as a city grew from 200 to 14,000 people during that place of time. And strategically located right where we are today, long before Trinity High School was built, this church was ready when the school went in and began immediately reaching out to those students at Trinity High School, and Bill was the guy to do it. 1,200 people were baptized during those 10 years. And it was notable because they also had mission points at various places in various states, but also in Mexico. One great story was that a Mexican pastor really needed milk for his family, and he didn't have a storage way to store the milk that we would send down to him. He was a pastor with 7 daughters from age 3 to age 11. That's an unusual sized family right there. Bill Anderson came up with the great idea of milk storage. He says the best milk storage there is a cow. Let's just take him a cow. And so they took him a cow and solved the issue. Also in our historical book are 2 awesome looking 50s era pickups that they took to Mexico to make sure that they could get to all the places to share the gospel. Those were some of the things that God did through Bill Anderson in that era. Jimmy Draper said about Bill Anderson that he laid the modern era for our church today, that the foundations that were laid then, of family and love and commitment from a pastor to people, was laid during that time. Jimmy also said, and I'd never heard this before until Jimmy Draper said it, he said, when Bill Anderson walked in the room, people said, everything's going to be okay, Bill's here. I want you to reflect on that for just a moment. What kind of confidence do you have to have in a man to say that about him if that's a fact? Now, those two guys have known each other for 70 years, ever since they went to college in Baylor. And actually, when Bill left for Florida, he recommended Jimmy to come from First Baptist Dallas to pastor the church here. And when Jimmy came, it was like, I mean, God called him, but God used Bill Anderson to get him here. What an incredible foundation was laid during that Building the Family era. In 1975, we began what's called the Defending the Faith era. And Jimmy Draper and Carol Ann became pastor and wife here during that era. When Jimmy talks about the church during that era, he talks about the Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night schedules, along with outreach and intercessory prayer room. The church is really what people's lives revolved around. They were involved deeply in the activities of the church because it furthered ministry. Now, Jimmy was an expository preacher, still is an expository preacher. He preached the Bible verse by verse by verse, including that message where he preached about the death of America and the issue of abortion. And some of the laymen walked out of that meeting that day and said, we have to do something about this problem in our area. And that's exactly what began, just expository preaching, the facts from the scripture that we needed to hear. Now, this has always been an evangelistic church. Now, for those of you that don't know what evangelistic means, it means we want lots of people to hear the good news. There were 26 itinerant and vocational evangelists in our church during Jimmy's era. That means that this was their home church, but they might preach in different churches during the year in different various weeks, but they were come back to this area, and this was their home church because this is where they were supported and fed and encouraged in the sense of the Word of God, spiritually speaking. The Bailey Smith Crusade, we talked about that earlier today. Bailey Smith, an evangelist, came in and began to preach. What ended up being a multi-week revival, 500 people came to faith during the Bailey Smith Crusade back in that era. And what an incredible thing that was to be able to baptize people who came to faith during that era. Kenya was big on this church's heart because Pastor Draper led the church to have what's called the Kenya Coastal Crusades. And some 65,000 people came to faith in Christ during those crusades led by Dr. Draper and other churches that came and joined with us. Might be interesting for you to know that also that took place during the next era where Kenya was a frequent place of visitation for us to go and share the gospel. And even in this era, I mean, I was in Kenya last year. We have two church members that have moved from here to Nairobi, Kenya. Can you imagine that? And there'll be another foundation for us to reach people all the way on the other side of the world. But we call this era the Defending of Faith era because of what we knew about the church if you were an outsider. Now, I'm not an insider in the sense of I wasn't raised here, but as a young pastor in the era in which Dr. Draper pastored, I knew the battle for the Bible was real. I knew people were beginning to cause doubt upon the Scripture. They were beginning to back off a commitment to the Scripture of the inerrancy of the Bible. And Jimmy Draper was the man that God used in many, many ways to lead a very large convention of churches to embrace the Bible wholeheartedly. He was a defender of the faith during an important, important era. And we are extremely grateful for that. The prayer room story. By the way, let's say thank you. He's in the room. He led the Defending of the Faith movement in the Southern Baptist Convention. Thank you, Dr. Draper. Intercessory prayer was a big part of the church life. And intercessory prayer means you sign up enough people to cover the 168 hours of a week. While they were having that emphasis one night, one meeting night, Ron Dunn was preaching, as I understand it, and they were enlisting people to sign up for the prayer room. They'd laid all the foundations. They needed 168 people to fill it up. And in the middle of the meeting, a storm broke, and rain came down so much that they couldn't even get outside the church building. They had to stay in the room. So they stayed in the room and recruited, and by the time the rain let up, they had 168 prayer commitments to fill the prayer room. And police used to park their cars outside the intercessory prayer room, partly because they wanted to make sure that those that came at 2 or 3 in the morning were protected, but partly because they wanted to see what it looked like for a church to pray around the clock for the needs of the community. That was that era. Now, I remember as a young man going to Six Flags during that period of time, but not just Six Flags on any day, but Christian Family Day at Six Flags. How many of you remember that? Would you raise your hand? Did you know that originated here in this church? that they began to appeal to Six Flags that we could have a Christian Family Day. And eventually, 40,000 people showed up for Christian Family Day. Christian concerts, the gospel was presented. We have a great picture of Jimmy Draper preaching, sharing the gospel at a Christian Family Fun Day at Six Flags. And get this, 4,300 people were baptized during that era. 4,600 people were baptized during that era. What an amazing, amazing testimony. Now, Jimmy, it was you that led us to purchase the rest of the property that we have today. One interesting thing about that, they prayer walked the property. Jimmy told me one day, I don't think it was in confidence because I think I've heard you say it publicly as well. As he walked the property and prayed and claimed it for the church, there was one corner that he just didn't walk. It was kind of a shortcut of the corner over here. And that ended up being a mobile gas station, and now we have a Popeye's, thanks to Jimmy Draper. Popeye's chicken, hard to beat. He knows I'm only kidding. There are so many things we're grateful for the Drapers and what God did through their lives. What an incredible, incredible opportunity. When Jimmy became president of the Southern Baptist Convention, he was gone for 2 years during the week. Here most Sundays preaching, but gone during the week. The deacons actually met without him to determine, yes, let's let him go, but let's shepherd the church. Let's help take care of the church while he's gone. Jimmy tells me that more people joined the church when he was president of the Southern Baptist Convention and gone all week than it had in other years, that the church body took care of each and every person in the church so well that that's what happened in the church during that time. What a great testimony to the power of a church and the love that people have for each other. The next era was what we call expanding the vision era. Claude Thomas was pastor from 1992 to 2006. And one word, one phrase describes a lot of what took place, and that was explosive growth. The church had really outgrown its facilities, and it had additional properties, but it was time to build. And as Claude says, building a worship center wasn't my first idea. Others had the idea, but at that time, we needed to do that. And so the building of the preschool and the building of this worship center that we're in here today took place during that period of time. They also bought a grocery store. That's what we now know as Campus West was purchased during that era for about $1 million. It was purchased very quickly because it was needed very quickly. And that's one of those great stories about how the church had to move quickly in order to acquire the land that was across the street. I've already mentioned Broken Ground. John Brooks is in the room today. And John, people often talk about the student ministry of that era and Broken Ground. We actually heard it mentioned up here where you went to various cities with Broken Ground and attracted people's attention in the public and then shared the gospel with them person to person in Boston and various large cities. What a great testimony to what God is doing in the lives of young people during that era. Prayer was also a big deal during that era. By the way, prayer has always been a big focus of every era of our church as far as I can see. And I think that's one of the clues that we walk away with, that we ought to always be focused on prayer. 4,300 people were baptized during the Claude Thomas era. And I think as an outsider, I saw the defending of the faith taking place through First Euless during the Draper era. But I also saw something else happening during the Claude Thomas era, and that's what I would call celebratory worship. We Baptists can be pretty quiet sometimes about our worship, but Euless wasn't quiet. They were pretty exuberant, pretty enthusiastic about the worship of God. And other churches took note of that. It was really a time of movement towards celebratory worship, where we could actually celebrate and rejoice in ways that we might not feel like we could have done in the past, and that was during that era. And this worship center that we're in, we're so grateful for week in and week out. That's expanding the vision era. Many of you came to faith during that era. Then the final era, the era we're in here today, is called Embracing the Future from 2006 to the present day. You know, when I was called to pastor this church, something very special happened to me, not only in the calling of the church, but in getting to know the two men that I've mentioned a couple of times today, Bill Anderson and Jimmy Draper. When I came in view of a call, in Baptist life, you come and you are in view of a call during a week of meetings, and you get to know the church as much as you can. The church gets to know you as much as they can. But one day, I had the opportunity to fly into Dallas-Fort Worth from Chattanooga, Tennessee, where I was, and meet with just Bill Anderson and Jimmy Draper all day long. And I can't tell you the privilege it's been for me to hear about the church from their perspective, to hear about their heart for the church and what the need of the church was at the moment, to watch them ask me questions, some of them quite tough, because what they wanted to do was make sure that whoever God called here would be ready to take care of the body, to shepherd the body, to love the body. And I have to tell you that since I've been here 18 years, those two men have continued to be there for me. I stand on their shoulders as well as Claude Thomas's shoulders in many ways. I stand on their shoulders as a pastor today, and I'm very grateful for that. That was one of the great highlights of my whole ministry, getting to know these guys in that way. We were $7 million in debt, almost $7 million in debt. When I came, we were almost halfway paying it through. Already the people of this church were talking about the miracle. That was the name it was given. Because Bill Anderson had said during that interim period that if you just bring $20 a week or something like that, whatever God leads you to give, we can pay this debt off in a record time. And so it was paid off in 28 months, nearly $7 million worth of debt. Well, what a miracle. We always give thanks to that. But what happened is not just that the debt was paid off, but that the people kept giving. And I remember coming back the next week saying, well, we paid the miracle off last week. This was July of 2007. But we received an additional $280,000 towards the miracle, and the miracle is designed to pay it off, and now it's paid off. What do we do with the money? And so we brought a team together. What Baptists do is they bring teams together and talk about it and pray about it. And over the next 10 years, people kept giving to the miracle, allowing us to start church plants, allowing us to fund different ministries. We helped fund a Mandarin copy of the scriptures, translation of the scriptures for China in the Beijing Olympics in 2008. We did all kinds of things like that. And it gave us the opportunity to start ministries that were local, like Six Stones and other ministries like that. Kids Beach Club was started during that era. Over and over, it seemed like God was working outside the walls of the church as well as he was inside the walls of the church. If you're a part of the church here, you know we do something called the Jericho Prayer. I was preaching through the book of Jericho, and we asked people to just come and ask God to tear the walls down through prayer. And that's really what started what we do every Sunday morning as we call out to God. And we saw that happen over and over. The cross service, not a shame service. Those were times where God moved in great, great ways. And we were able to see 3,200 people baptized over the last few years. And we are excited about that as well. Isn't it great to know that God will use the church in any and every era to bring people to faith? Now, you may not know this, but ULIS has changed and diversified much over the years. Trinity High School, I understand, is the most diverse high school in America. So it wasn't a shock to us. Amen. We're thankful that God has brought the world to our doorstep. So what God did, of course, was raise up other congregations within our congregation, other arms of Cross City Church. For example, the International Ministry, ministering to people from the Pacific Rim countries, as well as various countries in Africa. It's an expression of our church in that room at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. And then Cross City Espanol was started about 12 years ago as well. And today, Chuy Avila leads a great and strong ministry of Spanish speakers in our church. Of course, Ed Coe is our pastor of our international ministry. And recently, we've been able to start a mission, the North Campus, and we bought land in Haslett, Texas, and they're meeting now at 10 a.m. is when they meet, and we know that God is going to allow us to reach more people in the northwest part of Tarrant County in the years ahead. It's just more of the same. God is just providing. God is opening doors. God is allowing us to reach more and more people for Christ. Let me just say that during some very challenging eras in the last few years, God's people have come through so often in so many ways. Even COVID did not slow us down, and that's kind of amazing. You know, when we rebuilt our buildings called the Generation Project, we had a commitment day of the first Sunday in March of 2020, and then we were going to announce it the second Sunday of March in 2020. We announced it, and then the next Sunday we didn't meet, and the next one we didn't meet, because those were the 11 weeks we did not meet during COVID. And there were various times that we looked at each other and said, did we time this building program wrong, maybe? And then we looked back and said, no, God led us. And do you know we came in under budget, on time, paid for within a month after we built these buildings that you're in today. I'm grateful to God for the way he's provided. See, God is big enough to do whatever needs to be done in whatever area of church life. But let me just kind of hone in on a few things before we conclude today. There's a key characteristic of our church that remains true and has been in each era. I wrote this out. Our church has had a lifelong commitment to the authority and power of Scripture. We're not a church that doubts, questions, or ignores scriptural truth. This is important to us. It's important to us that the pulpit doesn't waver, that the classes where we teach the Bible don't waver. We're not wavering. We're not emergent. We're not progressive. We're not deconstructed. We're just people that believe simply the Word of God can change lives. The gospel touches people and always will. That's one key, I believe, as to why God has blessed this church in such a huge way. Something else that goes along with that, changed lives happen when the scripture is applied to a person's life. Now, I've made kind of an attempt to estimate how many lives have been touched over the history of this church. And I can count, just in the last 60 years, I can legitimately count maybe 14,000 to 15,000 baptisms. But when it comes to talking about the whole history, when it comes to talking about how this church has impacted people in other countries, other nations, and through giving to missions in all different places in the world, it has to be more than a million lives have been touched through this church over the years. That's conservative. I saw this the other day, and I think it's too, what you give to God, he multiplies. What you give to God financially, what you give to God when it comes to your service, he multiplies. So let me just bring this to a conclusion here in the next few moments. I want to take you on a remembrance journey for just a second. I want you to let it be personal and real. I'm going to remind you that Psalm 77:11 says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I want you to remember not what someone else said, but I want you to remember what God has done in your life through the influence of this church. Walk with me through this. Remember the seasons and times when God convicted you or drew you or demonstrated his love for you or spoke to you through someone else, where a message from the pulpit got your attention, or where a brother or sister comes up and says, can we talk, and it got your attention. Think about the times that God shaped you and fitted you for service. Think about when he gave you a mission in life. That's the goodness of God. I want you to think about and remember the moments and movements where God's presence and God's provision were so obvious and so evident that we had to say, who but God? That's the goodness of God. When you don't see how things can work out the way they do, where you don't see how something is brought back from a devastating circumstance, and then you hear the praise request that says, oh, God, touch their lives. Oh, God, help them in that. That's the goodness of God. I want you to remember the challenging and difficult times that you personally experienced, where you came to worship even though your heart didn't feel like it, and even though your mind says everything's out of control, and somehow God showed up with his presence and his power and restored you and reassured you. That's the goodness of God. And I want you to remember the times, if you will, for just a few moments, of the way God worked through you with his goodness. Not only touching your life, but touching the lives of those around you, because you brought love and you brought hope and you brought future to someone because you were just telling them what God did in your life. That's the goodness of God. Everywhere you look, you see the goodness of God, and God is going to continue to work in a powerful way. Amen. Think about the world we live in. Think about how confused the world is, how dark the world is, how desperate the world is. In every sense, the community needs the church more now than they ever have. And they need it in the same way we have been, on point with Scripture in the Word of God and the Gospel. But the church needs you. The church needs each and every one of us to stand on the shoulders of those who went before us and be the shoulders for those who are to come. Think about those that impacted you, whose shoulders you stand on. Think about those that are going to stand on your shoulders. On the 75th anniversary, 45 years ago, Bill Anderson said, "Not an inch of this came easy, and the next inch will not come easily. There's a price to pay in doing the work of Jesus." Jimmy Draper said, 45 years ago, "The church must be committed to change and to ministry, as it has been committed to change in the past. It's changed its name 3 times, I think 5 times now. Its location 3 times. It's enlarged the borders. It's increased its vision, and the future promises to be just the same." And so as the pastor today, I say, let's move forward, standing on the shoulders of those that went before us. Thank you for those that were willing to be the shoulders we stand on today. God is blessing that in a rich, rich way. We've experienced the goodness of God to us, but we also have seen the goodness of God shared through us to hundreds and thousands of people. In Romans chapter 16, there's a passage of scripture that I'm going to put on the screen. And it's Paul's commendation. It's his saluting a group of people at the Church of Rome. And I'm not going to read this all, but I'm just going to ask it to go on the screen for just a second. And I want you to know the names. Phoebe, he mentions Phoebe, Prisca, and Aquila. As you scroll through the first 16 verses of Romans chapter 1, you'll find Paul is naming name after name of persons who he says to them, "I salute you." The word greet literally means salute in the Greek. He's saying, "I salute the work that God has done through you, and I'm counting on you to keep the church moving forward." The reason I love this passage is because this is the passage that back in that day would represent this day, where we say a Bill or a Tommy or a Jack or a Cheryl or a Mary, "I salute you because you love the Lord, you serve the Lord, you walk together with the church as it moves forward." And what I want you to leave with a sense of today is not just a sense of history, but a sense of the fact that you are part of future history. Paul named these names 2,000 years ago. The Holy Spirit said, "We're going to record it in the Bible," because we want you to know that individuals through the years have made the church move forward. And that's you. And we're grateful for you. In just a few moments, I'm going to close this in prayer. We're going to have a couple of special presentations. Our mayor is going to come up and read a proclamation. Then Jimmy Draper is going to close us with a prayer of blessing, and then we'll be dismissed. And let me just say to you that today, I hope that you hang around a little bit. There's a food truck available if you want to purchase some food for your family. There are refreshments there if you want just simply something light. The history wall is there for you to see. The displays are there as well. And I want to give 3 invitations for those of you today that maybe not here every week, but number one, I want to invite you at the end of our service to stop by the decision stations. Our decision stations are there to have people there to talk to you about any decisions that you may need to make. I invite you to come to the guest reception room. Secondly, if you're a guest today, maybe the first time and you're wondering, what's all this history about? Well, I'd love to explain to you what our church is all about. Love to meet you personally. Join me outside the center exit doors and across the hallway. And then lastly, we invite you to come back next week as we continue the ministry that we have been doing for 120 years. I'm going to invite our mayor to the stage right now, Mayor Linda Martin, the Honorable Linda Martin. Would you welcome her as she comes today? Linda, come on up here. There's a long walk across this stage. And, you know, I told her when she came earlier today, I told her that we weren't going to require too much of her, but I did say she was going to have to sing Amazing Grace by herself. And she did not bite an eyelash. She had an answer for me, and it wasn't a yes answer, but she knew how to handle controversy nonetheless. Funny, are you going to sing?
Funny you should mention music. That powerful, uplifting music.
Oh, I loved it too. Didn't you love it today?
Unbelievable. And I told you I can't sing, but I sang loud and proud.
Okay. All right. So, she can do it.
Because I do remember, God said, make a joyful noise. So to all of you sitting down here, I'm sorry.
Amen, that's a great word.
What a pleasure it is to stand in front of you in this great worship center where we honestly feel God's love all around us. I'm glad to be here. Now I'm proudly going to present a proclamation to this entire congregation. I'm shaking a little because I'm really cold. Honestly, that's the reason. Whereas Cross City Church in Euless, Texas, traces its origins back to March 26, 1904, when Tarrant County missionary J.T. Bussey held an... I'm shaking too bad. No, thank you. An organizational meeting in the home of Charles Fitch for the purpose of starting a missionary Baptist church. And whereas originally known as the First Baptist Church of Euless, and most of us will probably call it First Euless forever.
It's okay.
The church faithfully served its members and the surrounding community for 120 years, relocating and expanding to accommodate its steady growth and the evolving needs of its congregation. And whereas under the leadership of many visionary and devoted pastors, Cross City Church has consistently sought to impact lives and inspire positive change, fostering a spirit of unity and faith among its members. And whereas Cross City Church has gone beyond its own walls, including founding Six Stones in 2008, a nonprofit organization created to provide vital resources and assistance to the Hearst, Euless, Bedford area. And whereas for over a century, Cross City Church has remained a pillar of strength, hope, and service in the community, exemplifying the values of compassion, faith, and outreach, while continually adapting to meet the spiritual and physical needs of those it serves. And whereas the city of Euless and its residents honor Cross City Church for its lasting dedication to improving the lives of all who call this community home, and for its unwavering support in strengthening the bonds between neighbors and generations. Now, therefore, I, Linda Martin, mayor of the city of Euless, do hereby recognize and celebrate Cross City Church's 120th anniversary and extend our deepest gratitude for its enduring commitment to the betterment of our community and the lasting impact of its ministry. In witness thereof, I have signed my name and affixed the official seal of the city hereto on the 8th day of September, 2024. Congratulations, Cross City.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now, Mayor Martin, I want to thank you because over all the years, a lot of the mayors, city council members, have been members of this church. So we've been very much a part of the city, as well as larger metroplex, and the city's been very much a part of our church. So thank you.
Amen.
And thank you all for the support that y'all have given to us.
Stand.
All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you that we come in your name. We come in the name of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. We thank you that you have moved through us over 120 years to bring us to this day. You've guided us. You've done things we could never have done by ourselves. We thank you for that. And we thank you that we serve a God who's able to do things that seem impossible. That has happened, and we're grateful. Thank you for our city that has encouraged us and that has let us live in it, serve in it, minister in it. We're grateful for the lives that have been touched, the ministry that has extended globally, and we're grateful for just including us as a small part of it. Thank you for Pastor John. Thank you for his leadership. Thank you that because of his vision and commitment and because of the history and the support of the past, we stand on solid foundation and look forward to an even greater future. We are blessed and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you.